gentlemen, I'm sure you'd all like to know something about the new entertainment miracle.
Programmed cell death.
Well, the best way I can describe it to you is to tell you that it makes the screen absolutely real and alive. Of course, these illustrations are only a pale suggestion of the real thing. It can't be described. It's got to be seen and experienced. I tell you, from its size and its appearance, there's some form of life in it. What do you want? What are you doing? Let me see you as you really are.
Cell, I guess you would define it as the ultimate unit of life, in the sense that anything that's alive is either a cell or it's made up of cells.
What's a cell? I think I would start with von Leeuwenhoek, who in 15-something made the first microscope. And using it, he looked at onion skins. And he found that the onion skin was broken up into square bits. And these looked like the cells that monks live in. And so he called them cells. And that's what most plant cells look like, squares with walls between them. Animal cells don't look like that. They're round, and they don't have walls. They have very, very thin partitions that are more like soap bubbles. What do cells do? They talk to each other. They help each other live. They kill each other. They regenerate themselves.
They move around. They eat other cells. They do everything an animal can do.
And those cells come together as communities. And those communities we call animals and plants.
Ein Organismus besteht aus vielen Zellen. Und diese Zellen sind wie die Individuen in einem, sagen wir mal, Stadtverband, wie einzelne Personen. Sie müssen zusammenarbeiten, sie müssen miteinander kommunizieren und interagieren. Und diese Kommunikation und Interaktion als Gesamtes ergibt den Organismus.
I think that's a useful way of viewing an animal or a plant, that it is a community of cells that have to interact and obey the rules that a community of individuals would have to. But in addition, the cells have to become different kinds of cells, a muscle cell, a nerve cell, a red blood cell, and so on.
Every man has a job to perform.
In addition, if we simply made a mass of cells, a big blob of nerve cells, muscle cells, intestinal cells, and so on, we would hardly be people. All of those cells must get together at the proper place and, in fact, at the proper time in order to form the structures that we know to be organisms.
Pendant très longtemps sur Terre, il n'y a eu que des organismes unicellulaires, donc vivant à l'état de cellules isolées. À un certain moment, et cette notion de moment peut recouvrir en fait des temps très longs, il y a eu émergence, apparition d'organismes multicellulaires, c'est-à-dire faits de plusieurs cellules.
Unicellular organism to evolve into a multicellular organism is an enormously complex process. And in fact, if you look at the fossil record, it took some 3 billion years after the first appearance of unicellular organisms to the first multicellular organism. So this took an enormously long time. And when you think about what would be necessary, it's not surprising. Before a collection of cells is useful as an organism, where they will actually work together for the benefit of a single organism, then the behavior of every cell has to be controlled. You needed to have complex mechanisms in place to control the behavior of every cell in that animal, so that it's an advantage to the collection of cells as a whole. Now, it's clear that they've evolved from the social interactions that unicellular organisms use. Because single-cell animals not infrequently are social to the extent that they interact with their neighbors for the purpose of sexual reproduction, for example. In the winter, let me bring the spring to you. There's a lot of social interactions between unicellular organisms, probably many more than we understand now.
Okay, cells in our bodies are not isolated entities. They have to know about each other, and they have to talk to each other.
Und wie sprechen diese Zellen miteinander?
Wie sprechen Zellen miteinander? Ja, sie sprechen eigentlich so miteinander, wie wir beide das jetzt tun.
And they do that in many complicated ways, but in general, they send signals to one another. Hundreds, thousands of different signals, each one telling the cell to do something slightly different. The behavior of an individual cell in an animal is coordinated by signals from other cells. So cells don't do anything unless they're signaled to do it, it seems. People are constantly being bombarded with signals and behaving according to these signals. Every time you drive your car, you're tuning into signals of all kinds, horns, eye contact, traffic lights, and so on. You're tuning into all kinds of sounds, and very subtle visual differences are cueing you. In an organism such as ourselves, cells obey these signals in exactly the same way. Hundreds and hundreds of different signals have been defined. Some of them are proteins, some of them are small molecules, some of them are gases even. They're saying move or don't move, or grow or don't grow, or divide or don't divide, or release this molecule that you've been storing, that kind of thing.
Get a behavior from a whole group of individuals. And at other times, you may want to get that behavior from some small portion of that group of individuals. For example, if I want both my sheepdogs to lay down, I say lay down, and they both go down. If I only want Annie to lay down, I put my hand up, and Annie goes down, but Poppy keeps going. If I say viens, Annie comes. If I say come, both of them come. Right. Now, the immune system does the same thing. Sometimes it wants to signal all of the white blood cells to grow, and it uses certain hormones to which all of those white blood cells respond. Sometimes it only wants the killer cells to grow, so it uses a different signal, and only the killer cells grow.
And those are considered to be social controls to ensure that a cell only divides when new cells are needed.
Thank you.
any one cell is listening to hundreds of signals at any one time. And has to integrate all those signals and decide to do something, like to move or not move, or divide or not divide. For example, if you were hearing the voices of many people telling you what to do, you're in a situation, you're in a room, and the room's on fire, and somebody's saying, go to the window, and somebody else saying, go to the door, and the other one saying, turn off the light, you know, put blankets under the door cracks. All those things are happening all at once, people screaming at you. The thing you don't want to do is to be paralyzed. You need to integrate all these things and make a decision and run for the door or run for the window or do something. And so a cell is integrating all these signals all of the time and making these all or none decisions. Move, divide, stay where you are, become something else. And these are very complex integration events that are happening inside the cell, and we don't understand how a cell does it. How do we know that cells receive all these signals and they regulate all these activities? Well, one way you know is if you take a cell and put it alone in a culture dish and remove all the signals. It doesn't divide, it doesn't move. In fact, it doesn't survive. And it turns out that for cells to stay alive, they need signals from other cells to tell them to stay alive. And if they don't get those signals, then they kill themselves.
Happening all the time. I mean, cells are dying in us all the time.
During the course of an hour, billions of your cells will die by programmed cell death. They'll commit suicide. The cells are programmed to die automatically, it seems. That the only reason it's not killing itself, the only reason any cell in your body is alive, the only reason is that other cells are constantly telling you.
Dans le domaine de la mort cellulaire, il est extrêmement tentant de faire appel à des images empruntées à la mort de l'individu, en particulier la mort humaine. L'exemple a fait beaucoup pour populariser le domaine, mais également pour figer un petit peu la pensée dans une certaine interprétation. Le suicide d'une cellule n'est pas vraiment un suicide, dans la mesure où c'est pas la cellule qui décide de mourir.
I think the analogies are fair, and I think they're useful because they allow us to think in a familiar way. So by suicide, we mean there's an act of participation on the part of the cell that's dying.
La notion d'un phénomène actif en ce qui concerne la mort cellulaire vient d'une observation qui était que dans certains cas de mort cellulaire, la cellule doit synthétiser de nouvelles molécules pour mourir. Et si on bloque la synthèse de ces nouvelles molécules, en fait, la cellule ne peut pas mourir. Alors, ceci suggérait effectivement...
...intrinsic program. It can be activated by signals from other cells, so the cell's happily living, moving, doing its thing. It can receive signals that tell it to commit suicide, and it'll do this program.
These cells are not killed. They're told to die.
den Zelltod, der von außen induziert wird, vorstellen als das Drücken eines Klingelknopfes oder eines Todesknopfes, wenn man so will. Also der Tod klopft an die Tür und drückt die Klingel und veranlasst aber denjenigen, der quasi drin sitzt, den Tod von alleine zu bewerkstelligen.
So this is a coordinated program, just like the cell division program is a coordinated set of events that divides the cell in two. This is a coordinated set of events that kills the cell in a very neat way. And the cell goes through this little dance where its surface boils, then it shrinks and condenses and stops moving altogether.
The first step is basically kill. Take a happy, healthy cell and make it dead. The second step involves engulfing that dying cell corpse. And so there's a neighboring cell that swallows the dying cell. We'll call that step of engulfment. And then the third step that destroys the evidence. So we'll call here destroy, and that leaves you with nothing at the end.
It's a very important process because if the cell died in a messy sort of way and spilt all of its guts all over the place, that induces an inflammatory response, and that would be very dangerous for the animal. So this is a program to kill a cell neatly. It's remarkable that you take this complex structure and it's gone in an hour or so. This death program is enormously useful because you do need to get rid of a lot of cells to build a normal animal.
For example, look at our hands or feet, which are a little harder to display at the moment, and what you see are fingers and toes, and they're separated from each other. But if you looked at a developing human being in the womb, what you would see is the fingers and toes are not separated, but rather they're connected by webbing.
What happens is the cells in between die, right? So that the cells that are left are the ones that go to make the fingers.
The duck's foot is webbed. That's important for a duck. It swims and it uses its webbed foot as a paddle. The chicken foot developmentally undergoes programmed cell death. The duck foot does not. So we are more like chickens than ducks.
We haven't the vaguest idea of how that is controlled so that cells die between the digits and not where the digits should be. But that's a fact. The reason you have digits is because cell death sculpts them.
Thank you.
Another dramatic example is in the metamorphosis of a tadpole into a frog. That is signaled by a hormone, thyroid hormone, whose levels increase dramatically at the time of metamorphosis, and that effectively turns this tadpole into a frog. Now, in that process, the tail of the tadpole disappears. And it turns out the thyroid hormone signals the cells in the tail of the tadpole to commit suicide, to undergo programmed cell death. In other parts of the tadpole, thyroid hormone induces the cells to divide or to change into some other kind of cell. But in the tail, it induces cells to activate this death program and kill themselves.
There are many other examples of the way in which cell death affects us. In the development of our brains, again, in the embryo, as fetus, in the womb, as fetuses, as many as 80 or 90% of the nerve cells that are made died.
It's thought that the reason you do that is that it allows you to match the number of nerve cells to the number of target cells that they have to contact. So if you had to get the numbers exactly right, 10,000 cells here and 10,000 cells there, this would be extremely difficult to do in development and in evolution. But by overproducing these cells and having the ones that make contact appropriately survive and all the others you kill, you would enormously speed up both evolution and development.
You know, here you are making an animal from a single cell. And you would think, again, that process should be efficient and make the cells that you need, and that would make the organism. But instead, what happens in the development of every animal is more cells are made than are needed, and those cells die. So a normal aspect of the program of animal development is cell death, therefore programmed cell death.
Lors du développement normal, la nature agit en deux étapes. Il y a une première étape de mise en place par excès. Il y a un excès de cellules fabriquées. Et il y a une deuxième étape de correction par mort cellulaire. Et c'est cette correction par mort cellulaire, cette deuxième étape, qui aboutit au patron définitif de l'organisme.
All organisms develop from a single cell. And what happens is that cell divides and makes two, and then those two divide, each of them, to make a total of four. That goes on and on and on. And that's the basic problem that developmental biologists are trying to solve. How does this happen? And this problem has been very difficult to approach in complicated organisms like ourselves. We, for example, probably have on the order of 10 to the 13th, that is 1 followed by 13 zeros of cells. If you look in the microscopic roundworm that we study, what we see is that there are 959 cells. Count them. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, up to 959 in this individual, in this individual, in this individual. And in fact, by starting with the single-celled egg, and all of us start from single-celled eggs, if one looks at this worm, it's possible to simply look at that egg going from one cell to two and then two to four and trace the entire pattern of divisions that generates all of those 959 cells. That is not possible in an animal that has millions or trillions of trillions of cells. So this is a room in which we study the worms in a variety of ways and also grow them. If we come in here, we can see, for example, on this slide, here are worms growing in flasks, and they're eating bacteria. And we grow them both like that and also on these small petri dishes. And just to give you an idea of the small size of these worms, one of these petri dishes can hold 10,000 individual animals. These animals grow, they take from generation to generation, they take 3 days. So one animal can have maybe 300 to 400 offspring in 3 days, each of which can then have another 300 to 400 in another 3 days. So in 1 week from one animal, we can get 10,000 animals on a petri plate. We probably have, I would say we have maybe on the order of a billion worms. No, probably more than a billion worms. We probably have between a billion and a trillion worms. Between 10 to the 9 and 10 to the 12 would be the estimate of the number of worms we have. But not all of them are crawling around. Some are frozen and asleep. One way in which this animal has been analyzed is to look at the highest microscopic resolution possible at individual cells and within individual cells. And what's done is to take the worm, which is essentially shaped like a sausage, and cut it the same way one would slice a sausage from nose to tail, making about 20,000 different slices in this tiny 1 millimeter worm. What this has allowed is a complete reconstruction of the anatomy of the animal with every single cell and connections amongst the cells. When that was done, what was found was that more cells were made than the 959. To be precise, 131 more cells were made, but those cells are not present in the adult. They're not present because they undergo programmed cell death. Cell death is a cell fate. Some cells live and turn into muscle cells, other cells live and turn into nerve cells, and other cells die. Okay, so one question to be considered is why cells are made and destroyed instead of simply not made. And the answer to this, like the answer to many why questions in biology, is that's what's happened. Because the way in which our development works is based upon a history. It's based upon evolution. It's not that somebody designed the best way to make a human being, but rather that human beings evolved over many, many years from creatures that were in fact very different from us. And each step in this evolution is a small step, so that basically what evolution is a tinkering, a modifying of what has come before. And so one never goes back to the beginning and says, is this an efficient process? Maybe we can do it a better way, because that's not how it can happen. But instead, what has happened is that one builds step by step, going this way and that, and this way and that. And what you end up with is the organisms that we see today.
It's counterintuitive that there would be all this waste, that you would produce millions of animals so that only a few thousand would survive, or you'd produce billions of spermatozoa so that only one will fertilize the egg. In the same way, the fact that you produce so many cells during development that die and never serve a useful function in the animal. It's counterintuitive that there'd be this waste, but it turns out that over and over again, biologists have learned that this is how biology works. That in order to get a few things that work, the most efficient way of doing is produce thousands and pick the few that work. This is how biology works. That in order to get a few things that work, the most efficient way of doing is produce thousands and pick the few that work.
Ce qu'on peut imaginer, c'est qu'il y a une règle qui est une règle de base lors du développement, qui est cette règle de développement par excès, puis mort cellulaire de correction, et que cette règle est tellement importante qu'elle a été appliquée dès le développement des premiers organismes multicellulaires. Il y a un exemple d'organisme à la jonction unicellulaire-multicellulaire, qui est en fait une espèce de champignon primitif. Cet organisme existe à l'état unicellulaire dans de bonnes conditions alimentaires, disons. Et quand ces conditions alimentaires deviennent nettement plus mauvaises, les différentes cellules s'agrègent et au bout de 24 heures, on passe d'un organisme unicellulaire à un organisme multicellulaire.
In this slime mold, the individual cells live as free-living amoeba crawling along on the forest floor. But when conditions deteriorate, then they do this remarkable social thing. These amoebae come together to form a multicellular slug, this worm-like structure that crawls along, trying to find a better environment. And then the worm changes into a small plant-like structure, which now creates these very hardy cells called spores. So cell death is involved in this unusual life cycle when the slug stops migrating and forms this little plant-like structure called a fruiting body. It forms a stalk, and the stalk is formed from the corpses of dead cells off the ground. And when conditions get better, these spores now germinate to give rise to free-living amoeba again.
À chaque fois, ce qui prime, c'est l'organisme, et non pas les cellules constituant l'organisme. L'individu est prioritaire par rapport à ses cellules, et l'individu sacrifie une fraction de ses cellules pour se développer et pour survivre. Donc de ce point de vue-là, la mort cellulaire est nécessaire à la vie.
If you look in a mature human being, you look in the immune system, you find that as many as 95% of certain kinds of blood cells that are made die. Okay. Massive cell death. And if that cell death didn't occur, our immune systems basically would go haywire.
Alors le système immunitaire contient des cellules qui sont des cellules tueuses professionnelles. Dont la fonction semble être de détecter des cellules étrangères ou des cellules infectées ou des cellules cancéreuses, donc de les détecter puis de les éliminer.
The immune system has to be prepared for everything. And the way it does that is it generates zillions of these white blood cells. And they're generated in an organ called the thymus. These cells are amazing. They're the world's best microsurgeons. They can kill one virus-infected cell among a whole skin full of healthy cells and stop the infection. These millions and millions of white blood cells are randomly generated, each one able to see something different. There are cells in there able to recognize anything. Now, among all these cells, there's going to be some that recognize you, yourself. Your kidneys, your skin, your heart. And that's very dangerous. And if you didn't do something about them, they'd kill you. All those little microsurgeons going around, you'd die pretty quick. You want to get rid of those cells. So there's a point in their development in the thymus where any cell which can react against your own body is told to commit suicide. So most of the killer cells, most of the armies of killer cells commit suicide. But a small proportion stick around. And they start circulating around the body looking for danger.
So we need to generate a vast array of random types of cells. And we need to destroy the ones that are going to destroy us if we don't get to them first. Like any aspect of basic biology, cell death can go wrong and lead to disease.
Hallo?
Hallo.
Aline, wie geht's dir? Gut, du bist am Ende der Therapie.
Wir haben vor einigen Jahren hier in Heidelberg herauskommend mit dem Zelltod begonnen zu befassen und haben uns für die Frage damals interessiert, eigentlich wie Leukämiezellen wachsen. Und wir haben hier über viele Jahre Konzepte gehabt, dass bösartiges Wachstum basiert auf vermehrter Proliferation von Zellen. Also die vermehren sich alle ständig und das ist der Grund, warum man Krebs hat. Wir haben jetzt gelernt, dass das nur eine Seite der Wahrheit ist. Es gibt vielleicht eine ganz andere und das ist die, dass bösartige Zellen deshalb bösartig sind, weil sie nicht absterben können. Und wir haben jetzt die ersten Patienten identifiziert, die solche Defekte haben. Diese Patienten, diese Kinder entwickeln eine Ansammlung von solchen Immunzellen überall im Körper, die offensichtlich nicht absterben können. Wie geht's euch denn?
Gut.
Wer gewinnt? Die ideale Therapie würde so aussehen, dass wir verstehen, wie wir an einer Tumorzelle einen Klingelknopf installieren können, der ein Signal gibt für programmierten Zelltod.
Ja.
Therapievertrag
ist auch ganz gut. Es gibt Erkrankungen, bei denen ein zu viel von Zellen die Krankheit ist. Und das ist Krebs. Und dabei spielt ein Nicht-Absterben-Können eine Rolle. Es gibt sicher andere Erkrankungen, bei denen ein zu wenig von Zellen die Erkrankung ist. Das ist zum Beispiel AIDS. Und AIDS ist charakterisiert dadurch, dass Patienten, die mit dem Virus infiziert sind, im Lauf der Erkrankung eine bestimmte Gruppe ihrer Abwehrzellen verlieren.
HIV infects lymphocytes in very small numbers, it would seem. And it's also clear that that results in the death of an important class of lymphocytes, which makes the individual now susceptible to many infections that they otherwise wouldn't be susceptible to. But how this virus kills the cell remains controversial. One favorite hypothesis is that it induces the cell to undergo programmed cell death in some way. In fact, many cells that die seem to die even though they're not infected with the virus. And they seem to die by programmed cell death, at least that's one current view. How that happens remains unknown. But programmed cell death, when the answer is known and the dust clears, programmed cell death will be an important part of the answer. I think most people would think that's true. So it's really only been in the last few years that cell death has moved into center stage, where it's now there. So it is remarkable that something so fundamental has been ignored for so long.
Historiquement, la mort cellulaire a été étudiée en fait depuis au moins un siècle. Les études ont été faites, ont été publiées, ont été ensuite largement ignorées, ont été reprises au bout de 10-20 ans, les mêmes observations ont été refaites, republiées, réoubliées, reprises ensuite. Alors pourquoi ? Et ce qui a été difficile à imaginer, c'est le fait qu'un organisme entier apparemment intact pouvait en fait être le siège à la fois d'une mort cellulaire extrêmement intense et d'une division cellulaire extrêmement intense. Ce qui a été de nouveau difficile à imaginer, c'est la notion d'intégrité du tout accompagnée de la mort d'une partie des constituants. Il y a probablement une raison culturelle qui est que dans les civilisations occidentales, la notion de mort a un caractère répulsif en soi. La mort de l'individu, évidemment, et peut-être par extension, tout ce qui concerne la mort, y compris la mort de la cellule.
Yes, I think that when you're dealing with death, whether it be a cell or an organism, it's a, you know, it's kind of reminding you of your own mortality. This is the great human problem, is coming to grips with your own death. I think there probably was something about that, yeah, psychological explanation. It certainly requires some explanation because, you know, there were voices out there for many, many years saying, hey, cell death, very important, pay attention. And no one was paying attention other than these few people who were out there in the wilderness working on cell death. Even Rita, if you look at the history, she saw cell death very early. She wasn't the earliest, but she did see it early. And her most important contribution was the discovery of nerve growth factor, this factor that is a signal that is required for developing neurons, we now know, of some kinds to survive. But the connection between nerve growth factor and cell death was made many years after she had first found cell death in the nervous system in her own studies. It's remarkable.
Quando le leggi razziali 1938 hanno impedito a chi era considerato non di razza ariana, era il mio caso, di andare all'università, ho messo un laboratorio in camera da letto e ho fatto un esperimento sull'embrione di pollo che mi ha portato alla scoperta della morte della cellula nervosa. Un embrione di pollo naturalmente è una creaturina molto piccola con due abbozzi che sono gli arti, l'ala e la zampa. Tagliando con un ago uno di questi abbozzi, l'ala o l'arto, io mi sono resa conto che le cellule nervose che avevano iniziato a svilupparsi morivano. E da questo io sono arrivata alla conclusione che la cellula nervosa ha bisogno di qualche stimolo, ed era il tessuto, o qualche nutriente che veniva dal tessuto. Mancando questo tessuto periferico, l'abbozzo dell'arto o dell'ala, le cellule vanno incontro a morte. E quella è la prima dimostrazione di una degenerazione cellulare, perché la cellula nervosa in via di sviluppo non riceve messaggi dalla periferia che mancano. E io facevo sezioni, come si fanno normalmente, piccole sezioni una dopo l'altra a qualche ora di distanza. Quindi quel processo che è statico visto in una sezione diventa come al cinematografo, dinamico, perché un'ora dopo l'altra io potevo seguire la distruzione di queste cellule, la loro scomparsa, perché degli spazzini, che in quel caso erano i macrofagi, le portavano via. Noi sappiamo che questo avviene. Questo l'ho fatto nella mia camera da letto durante la guerra a Torino nel 1942-43-44. È stata una scoperta al momento sconvolgente. Io venivo dalla terribile esperienza della guerra, dai campi di battaglia, della morte. Io vedevo queste cellule morire come i soldati in guerra. Per per me era un riferimento a quello che è la vita normale, la vita tra gli uomini. Diciamo in una sezione microscopica, gli altri non vedono altro che puntini neri, io vedevo cellule che si muovevano e come in un campo di battaglia, feriti e morti. In me prevale la capacità intuitiva su quella raziocinante. Quindi è più un modo artistico portare avanti il mio lavoro che un modo cosiddetto scientifico. È il punto in comune della scienza e della cosiddetta arte, cioè intuizione. Diciamo che noi due siamo gemelli, abbiamo fatto una strada differente, è vero? Ma in certo senso c'è molta somiglianza nel modo di vedere o la vita, come io la vedo dal lato scientifico, dal lato artistico, come la vede lei.
Io chiamo i cosci. A me piacciono moltissimo le veneri del passato greco e romano, nel quale mancano le braccia o mancano delle parti del corpo che si possono intuire anche se non ci sono. Suggeriscono delle cose che non si vedono, ma che pure ci sono.
Questo è preso dagli esperimenti di Wilson, della camera che urtano. È un po' un ricordo dell'universo rivisto da una forma del tutto differente scientifica. Questa è la camera bolle. She simply took from a photo. This is a photo which she enlarged. So she interpreted something which is true, real.
E questa scultura rappresenta?
Che cosa rappresenta? C'è quelque chose. Lion, la vie et la mort. Je pense toujours à la vie et à la mort, comme à les deux extrémités de nos passions, de notre vie.
La vita e la morte sono due fenomeni strettamente correlati l'uno all'altro. Una cellula può, attraverso il ciclo di divisione cellulare, aumentare numericamente e poi differenziarsi, oppure può, con un ciclo abnorme cosiddetto, andare alla morte. Ma sono due cicli simili. In altro senso, noi abbiamo oggi un concetto dal punto di vista della morte a livello cellulare molto differente da quello di una volta. Si pensava un tempo che la morte fosse sempre una deprivazione, un'azione negativa. Oggi invece la vediamo anche come un fatto positivo. È un ciclo che si risolve nella morte anziché nell'aumento. È sempre un ciclo cellulare, cioè è un fatto fisiologico. Non è la fine, non è più quell'aspetto sinistro che noi leghiamo alla morte. Gioia. È insieme al sistema. Scusa, Gianni. E arrivederci.
Grazie.
Britain, there is a disdain for science. They put science and technology together into the same basket, and it is kind of menial. If you are trying to understand how something works, it's like being a plumber, right? The real essence of being an advanced human being is to listen to music, or to go to a play, or to think about philosophical issues. It's on a different plane. And that means that the politicians, the captains of industry, all these people are scientifically illiterate. They are making all these decisions on which our lives depend, on whether we should use nuclear power or not. you know, what the levels of pollution are acceptable. And all these decisions, which depend on understanding the science, they know no science. Not only do they not know any science, they don't want to know any science. They would consider it demeaning, somehow polluting their ethereal spirit. Isn't that depressing? That is depressing. Feynman, Richard Feynman, made this point explicitly when he says, you know, because I understand this rose, you know, I understand that it's made of cells, and I understand how the pigment is made, and I understand why I see it as red, you know, I understand the physics of the light reflection, and so on and so forth, in no way decreases my ability to appreciate the beauty of the rose. In fact, it increases my ability to appreciate the rose, because I see so much more in that rose.
Biology is all around us, and so we don't see it. It's like the one thing the fish swimming in the sea don't see is the water they're swimming in. We're swimming in biology, and so we don't see it.
the shadows while I come and sing to you, dear. In the shadows when I come.